Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written for people learning English.
Today, Mario Ritter Jr. tells us about a Laotian immigrant whose winning lottery ticket won him hundreds of millions of dollars. Dan Novak has this week's education report, and John Russell presents the lesson of the day. But first, Dan Friedell and I have this story.
The United States plans new rules for the movement of dairy cows between states because of concerns about a bird flu outbreak. The virus is called Type A H5N1. It has been found in over 30 different groups of cows across 8 states. Some inactive markers of the virus have been found in milk sold in stores. Inactive markers mean the virus is dead and cannot harm humans who drink the milk. The concern is that the virus could mutate or change. It could then possibly spread from cows or other animals to humans. Experts, however, believe the risk of that is low. After April 29th, cows must have been tested and found to not have the virus before they are permitted to be moved between states. The virus has been known by scientists to circulate among wild birds. It appears in other animals if they eat sick birds. Some animals that live near the sea have tested positive for the virus, including harbor seals and polar bears. Animals that eat grasses, such as cows and goats, have only recently been found to have the virus. Richard Webby is an influenza expert at St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital in Tennessee. He said, "Flu viruses are known for adapting to spread among new animals. Finding the virus in dairy milk raises concerns that it could spread to people," Webby said. Scientists confirmed the virus in cows in March after farmers said their cows were sick. They said the animals' symptoms included tiredness and low milk production. Some farmers said the milk the sick cows produced was thick and yellow. Matthew Aliota is an animal medicine researcher at the University of Minnesota. He said finding the inactive virus in the milk suggests this has been going on longer and is more widespread than we have previously recognized.
The U.S. Department of Agriculture recently sent out new genetic information about the virus. Michael Warraby is an evolutionary biologist with the University of Arizona. He said the federal agency information makes him think the virus moved from birds to cows late in 2023. Warraby said the virus likely spread among the cows due to contact with milking machines, trucks, or the shoes of farm workers. It then moves from cow to cow before making its way back to birds. Warraby said birds tested on the same farms as sick cows have a form of the virus with clear mammalian adaptations. In other words, the virus shows signs of changing before infecting the bird populations. Scientists say the best way to keep the virus from spreading to more cows, and possibly humans, is to test cows as often as possible and follow their movements. Thomas Friedrich is a virology expert at the University of Wisconsin's Animal Medical School. He said, We need to be able to do greater surveillance so that we know what's going on. Warraby said testing for active virus is one thing, but the tests must also look for antibodies or evidence of past infections. That is a really accessible and quick way to find out how widespread this is, he said. Scientists are working to be sure that heating up the milk before it is put into containers for humans to drink is enough to kill the virus. The process is called pasteurization. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration, FDA, will have more information about that soon.
Right now, the FDA recommends humans to avoid raw or unpasteurized milk. Farm workers are also being told to wear masks, wash their hands, and change their work clothes often, Aliota said. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention said 23 people have been tested for the virus so far. One person has tested positive for a mild eye infection. CDC officials are watching for signs of sickness in 44 other people who were in contact with infected animals. David O'Connor is a virus expert at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He said that knowing about the virus should not make humans change anything about how they live their daily lives. But he said humans should have increased awareness that something is happening. I'm Dan Friedell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
A Laotian immigrant who has battled cancer for 8 years will share hundreds of millions of dollars with a friend after winning a game of chance. 46-year-old Chung Sapan lives in Portland, Oregon. He spoke at a news conference held by the Oregon Lottery on Monday. He said he and his wife, Duan Pen, will take half of the prize money. He plans to give the rest to his friend. That friend, Liza Chow, gave $100 to buy lottery tickets with the couple. Saipan said he was told he had cancer in 2016. He has been undergoing cancer treatment since then. He told reporters that he received his latest chemotherapy treatment last week. With the money, he said, I will be able to provide for my family and my health. He added that he would find a good doctor. Sapan has 2 young children. He said, How am I going to have time to spend all of this money? How long will I live? He said he prayed that he would be able to provide something for his children before the prize announcement. After buying the lottery tickets, Chow sent a picture of the tickets to Sapan, saying, We're billionaires. That was before the winning numbers were announced. Chow was just making a joke. But the next day, the friends won. Chow was on her way to work when Sapan called her to tell her they had won the lottery. You don't have to go anymore, he said. Sapan told reporters he was born in Laos and moved to Thailand in 1987. He came to America in 1994. He has lived in the Portland area for 30 years. He worked as a machinist for an aerospace company. He appeared at the news conference wearing a piece of cloth that identified him as Yumien, a Southeast Asian ethnic group with roots in southern China. "I am born in Laos, but I am not Laotian," Sapan told reporters. "I am Yumien." The Yumien aided American forces during the Vietnam War. After the end of the conflict, they feared punishment from the communist fighters who took over the government. Thousands of Yumien fled Laos at the time. Tens of thousands of Yumien immigrated to the United States through a refugee rescue program. Many of them moved to the West Coast area. Many have attended universities and started businesses. The Yumien community in the Portland area is large, with a Buddhist temple, a Baptist church, social organizations, businesses, and restaurants. The Oregon lottery game is known as Powerball. Many other states hold Powerball lotteries. The announced prize was $1.3 billion. However, that total would be paid out over 30 years. Instead, the winners can choose to take a single payment that is lower. The reported total for the winners in Portland is about $422 million after federal and state taxes are taken out. Oregon does not permit winners of the Powerball lottery to keep their identities from the public, with a few exceptions. The prize is said to be the fourth largest Powerball prize in history. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
See if you know the answer to this riddle. I have been around for a very long time. Longer than toys, dogs, or anyone you know. My roots go back many centuries, some of them even longer. I can connect you to the past, the present, and the future. I make you human. Can you guess what I am? The answer is language. Children's author Victor D.O. Santos asks readers that question in his book, What Makes Us Human? Each page on the book provides a clue to the riddle's final answer. Artist Anna Forlati illustrated the book. Santos told VOA Learning English that the book is about the value of language. It is also meant to bring more attention to the world's native languages. Native and indigenous languages are disappearing quickly. The United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, estimates that 40% of the world's 7,000 languages may disappear by the year 2100. Santos, who is an educator and linguist, has studied indigenous languages in his native country, Brazil. He said that his new book brings attention to the fact that many languages are disappearing, and this linguistic heritage that we have in the world is slipping through the cracks. The United Nations has named the years between 2022 and 2032 as the International Decade of Indigenous Languages. UNESCO says the declaration is meant to bring worldwide attention on the critical situation of many indigenous languages. It also says it is meant to provide more resources to protect and revitalize such languages. Santos said UNESCO offered to partner with him and help expand the book's reach. the book has already been licensed into 22 different languages. That includes versions in Mapudungun, a language spoken by the Mapuche people in Chile and Argentina, and into Ñañu, a language spoken by the Otomi people in Mexico. Santos said the book might soon be published in native Hawaiian as well. The Chilean government recently published 27,000 copies of the book for public schools, where there is a large percentage of indigenous children. A large number of cultures and languages are represented in the book. Its final page has a drawing of people saying hello in many languages. There are characters saying hello in common languages like Arabic, English, and Spanish. And indigenous languages from the Chavant people in Brazil and the Cherokee people in the United States are also included. Another drawing has different scripts or writing systems hidden in trees. One page has drawings of 12 indigenous groups around the world wearing their traditional clothing. The words to go along with the drawing note the fact that indigenous languages around the world are disappearing. When one of me disappears, a culture may also disappear. A unique way to view and understand the world. Gone. Forever. Santos said his book has an adult layer to it. It's not just for kids. One page has a drawing of a parent and child fleeing a conflict or war. Another person is holding a sign that says, "No war." "I can show you love, but also hurt you," the page reads. Santos said he was thinking about the war in Ukraine for that page. The drawing referenced a Ukrainian reporter who interrupted a Russian state media report while holding that same sign. What Russia is doing to Ukraine is not just attacking their territory and killing Ukrainians, but it's denying their culture, said Santos, whose wife is Ukrainian and children have been raised speaking the language. They're imposing the Russian language in the Ukrainian territory. Santos said there are several ways to understand the page's message. "It's to make people aware that words have weight," he said. "Language can be used as a weapon and as a tool. And you can do good, or you can do ill with it." I'm Dan Novak.
Dan Novak joins me now to talk more about today's education report. Hi, Dan. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley.
You interviewed children's book writer Victor Santos. What more can you tell us about him?
Yeah, Victor wrote the book that I focused on for today's story, What Makes Us Human. He is a linguist and educator who was raised in Brazil but now lives in the U.S. He started a language company providing teaching materials for parents passing languages to their children, including a book series called Little Polyglot Adventures. He wrote his first children's book separate from that series in 2020 about being a father. Another one of his books that came out this year is about children watching a loved one go through dementia. So his books, though for kids, cover serious topics.
What Makes Us Human has been co-published by UNESCO. Why has UNESCO partnered with Santos on this book?
As I say in the story, the UN declared 2022 through 2032 the International Decade of Indigenous Languages. It's to help spread awareness about the disappearing of languages and hopefully get more resources into places to keep those languages alive. And UNESCO saw that Victor's book really illustrated the importance of language, and indigenous languages and culture in particular. But I just want to let listeners know that if they liked today's story, they should check out the article on our website. Included are some of the book's pages and illustrations. The book was illustrated by Anna Forlati, and I think they're really cool.
All right. Thanks so much for answering those questions, Dan. And thank you for that report.
No problem. See you next time.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
In this next report, Gregory Stockel tells us about the connection between artificial intelligence and deepfakes. Deepfakes are images, videos, or audio changed in a way to misrepresent a person or situation. Pay careful attention to the word context. We will talk more about it after the report.
Fake photos, videos, and audio are spreading online as a result of the rise and misuse of artificial intelligence, or AI, tools. And it is getting harder to tell what is real from what is not. Video and image creators like DALL-E, Midjourney, and OpenAI's Sora make it easy for people with little technical skills to create deep fakes. The fake images might seem harmless, but they can be used to cheat people out of money, steal identities, spread propaganda, and unfairly influence elections. Just a year ago, the technology was far from perfect, and it was easier to tell that a photo had been created with AI. Fake images then showed clear errors, like hands with six fingers or eyeglasses with different shapes. But as AI has improved, it has become a lot harder. Henry Agder is founder of the AI advising company Latent Space Advisory and a leading expert in generative AI. He said some widely shared advice, like looking for unnatural eye movements in people in deepfake videos, no longer holds. Still, there are some things to look for, he said. Agder said a lot of AI deepfake photos, especially of people, have a smoothing effect that leaves skin looking very polished. He warned, however, that AI can sometimes change the photos and remove the signs of AI creation. Look at shadows and lighting. Often the subject is clear and appears lifelike. But elements in the rest of the photo might not seem so real or polished. One of the most common deep fakes is exchanging one face for another. The practice is called face swapping. Experts advise looking closely at the edges of the face. Does the facial skin color match the rest of the head or body? Are the edges of the face sharp or unclear? If you suspect video of a person speaking has been changed by AI, look at their mouth. Do their lip movements line up with the audio perfectly? Cybersecurity company Norton says that the technology is not ready to create individual teeth. So Agder suggests looking at their teeth. Are they clear, or are they unclear and somehow do not appear like they would in real life? Sometimes the context of the photo is important. Take a minute to consider if what you are seeing could actually happen. The Pointer Journalism website advises that if you see a well-known person do something that seems unrealistic or unlike themselves, it could be a deep fake. Another method is to use AI to fight AI. Microsoft has developed a tool that can study photos or videos and rate if it has been changed. Technology company Intel's Fake Catcher uses computer programs to study the smallest parts of an image, called pixels, to say if it is real or fake. However, some of these tools are not available to the public. That is because researchers do not want to help bad actors improve their deep fakes. All this being said, AI has been developing very quickly, and AI models are being trained on internet data to produce increasingly better content with fewer mistakes. That means this advice to find deep fakes could be incorrect even a year from now. Experts say it might even be dangerous to suggest the average person can find deep fakes. That is because even for trained eyes, it is becoming increasingly difficult. I'm Gregory Stockel.
Before the report, we asked you to pay careful attention to the word context. Can you remember when you heard it? You heard the term used in relation to what is visible in an image. Let's listen again.
Sometimes the context of the photo is important. Take a minute to consider if what you are seeing could actually happen.
Context is a noun. We spell it like this. C-O-N-T-E-X-T. Context means the situation in which something happens. Consider this example. You see a photograph of a person standing in a forest. In other words, the photograph is taken in the context of a natural environment, the forest. Now imagine you see an image of a person flying in outer space without a spacesuit. You can probably guess that the image is not real because of the image's context. When we consider context in an image, we might ask, what is visible or happening in the image? Or, what is happening in the background? We can also ask about the context of videos and audio files. For example, you might wonder about the context in which a video or sound recording was made. But you should know that the word context has importance beyond discussions about deepfakes. In the news, we can consider how the writer or reporter describes a situation. In other words, what the context of the story is. We can also ask questions about context when we learn about history, politics, and so on. Let's end this lesson with a pronunciation activity. It is called backwards buildup. We start at the end of the word and add the sounds that come before it. Repeat after me. T, t, xt, xt, ext, ext, text, text, n-text, n-text, on-text, on-text, context, context. And that's the lesson of the day. I'm John Russell.
And that's our program for today.
Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.